All right, good evening, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to Skudik Institute and Acadia National Park, and also to the Acadia Science Symposium Eve. We are excited to be able to kick it off this evening with a talk by Dr. Stephanie Spera, and then tomorrow we have our full day session, which is available both in person and online, and hopefully you have registered already for the full day tomorrow for the symposium. We have lots of great talks by all sorts of researchers doing work here in Acadia. And as many of you may know, there's all sorts of good science. There's over 80 research projects per year happening in Acadia. And so it's really a hub for science to understand rapid change and stewardship of amazing places such as this cherished park. And tonight's talk is by, again, Stephanie Spera, who is a professor at the University of Richmond in Virginia. And she is also a second century stewardship fellow doing research here in Acadia. Second Century Stewardship, SCS. It's our one of our fellowship programs here that began back in 2016. And we've had 18 really great fellows, scientists doing work in the park. And actually we have the request for proposals is open right now. It's due in 10 days for the 2023 fellowship. So you can find out more on our website or go to scsparkscience.org. And so if you want to be able to do cool research in Acadia, like we're going to hear about tonight from Stephanie, then please check that out. And so with that, I'm going to hand it over to Steph to introduce herself and then to tell us a little bit more about climate change, fall foliage visitation. And there's one other thing I'm supposed to say. All right.
Thank you. Thanks, Nick. Ooh, hi, everyone. Right. Hello, everybody on Zoom as well. Right. So I am here to talk about the work I've been doing as a second century stewardship fellow here at Acadia National Park. And the first thing I want to do is tell you a little bit about myself, because as you may say, I'm from away. So how did I get here? So I am actually a physical geographer and a land change scientist. And actually a lot of my research questions have to do with how do we best manage our landscapes and how do we balance human needs with ecosystem functions. And so most of my work actually, given projects that I started with in graduate school, is focused on South America, which are these pictures that you see here. I spend a lot of time working in the Brazilian Cerrado, so that picture on the left is me in the town in Brazil that kills more pigs and grows more corn than any other town in Brazil. And then there's a lot of deforestation going on. Those are all cotton and corn fields taken from a prop plane. And then mapping land cover in the Peruvian Amazon and understanding really how these changes in land cover, just mapping these changes and understanding how they result in environmental consequences. So is it making the landscape hotter? Is it affecting the rain? Is it affecting the amount of water recycled back up in the atmosphere, the stream flow? But what's cool about this work, and this is not the talk you're here for tonight, I hope, or in the very wrong place, but what's cool about this research is that a lot of the tools and methods that I learned in graduate school, which involved terrestrial remote sensing, so how to analyze satellite data, GIS, spatial statistics, climate modeling, these are great methods and tools, and I'm not really tied to any location for using these tools and methods. So as fun as it is to pop down to South America every so often and do field work, a few years ago, I was looking for something a little more local, a little more applied, and something that was near and dear to my heart. So in 2018, I was a postdoc living in New Hampshire. I knew I was on the job market, and I knew I might have to leave New England, and I'd basically lived in every New England state over the last 30 years, except Connecticut, which doesn't really count because we all disregard Connecticut. And so when I saw the call, the SCS call for proposals, I love Acadia National Park. I love Maine. Selfishly, I was like, if I get this, I can come back to Maine with a real reason every year, no matter where I move to. Because I love fall, I love New England, I love Maine, I love Acadia National Park. I'm from Massachusetts, don't hold it against me if you're from Maine, but we used to vacation in Maine during the summer. This is me as a kid in the fall. This is me sticking my child and my cat in the fall in pictures. I love it so much. In graduate school, Acadia became a very special place to me. I would come, I came very frequently. We always camped at Seawall. And being from New England though, and having this granite running through my brains and loving fall so much, I thought even I noticed fall was getting later. And I thought even I noticed the falls weren't as vibrant as they were when I was a kid. That could have just been me getting older. But basically, when I had the opportunity to investigate what was happening with fall foliage at Acadia National Park, I took it. So that is how I got here today. And this is the talk I hope you've come for. Nothing about the Amazon. So my original research goal with this big project was to understand how changes in climate has affected the timing and duration of fall foliage in Acadia National Park, and if this has affected visitorship in the park. I came up to Acadia in the fall a bunch during graduate school. I felt like it was getting more crowded. Is it getting more crowded? It is getting more crowded in the fall. And if visitors were really thinking about that when they were planning their trips. So basically my talk today is walking you through my crazy research plan and how it's gone and all of the ways, all the fun twists and turns that it's taken. So these are the four questions that we're gonna answer by the end of the talk. How has Acadia National Park's climate changed? We're not gonna answer how has the onset and duration of fall foliage changed, because that was a really tough question to answer. But we're gonna talk about how the timing of peak fall foliage has changed over time. We're gonna talk about how changes in climate have affected fall foliage. And then we're gonna touch on, this is the stuff I'm still doing, do fall in Acadia National Park, I sometimes abbreviate it ANP because I'm lazy. Visitors consider the timing of fall foliage when they plan their trips in September and October. So by the end of the talk, we should have answers to all of these questions. Okay, let's start at the top. So we know that Maine's climate has been changing, right? This is the map on the right, is the 2021 annual temperature anomaly. I admit it's not my favorite map ever, but I didn't make it, so I can say that, because it's all red. And basically what you see compared to the 1901 to 2000 climate baseline, the average temperature, it's getting hotter, it's redder, right? So annual temperature in Maine is up 3.2 degrees since 1895. Annual precipitation has increased by 6 inches, which is a lot. If you remember last Friday, more frequent extreme precipitation events are happening, reduced snowpack. The winter is 2 weeks shorter, the summer is 2 weeks warmer and longer, and there's gonna be sea level rise here, right? And I wanna talk about the way they make these maps, because this is how I thought I could initially start to analyze Acadia National Park climate. Oh, these are just more graphs to show you how scary it is, climate change is happening. So this is annual maximum temperature, particularly if you look at the last half of the graph, you'll see that temperatures are rising. It's actually, this is the minimum temperature. So the coolest it gets at night is not getting that cold anymore. And you see that that line is rising a lot more steadily than the days. So nights are getting warmer faster than days are getting warmer across Maine. Precipitation, if you're a climate scientist, precipitation is always a hot mess. It's really, really, really tricky. This is a precipitation anomaly graph. So you have the year on the x-axis and the anomaly on the y-axis. So what they did was they took the average precipitation across 1901 to 2000, and then they said, how much more or less rain did each year get? So green is more rain in that year than average, orange is less rain. And what you'll notice is that it's variable every year. If you ask any climate statistician, any climate modeler, precipitation's the hardest variable to nail down, the hardest variable to see a trend line in. But you will notice that during the first half of that graph, there are ups and downs. They really stay within a small bounds, right? Between -5 and 5, up and down, wet years and dry years. The farther you get this way, the more variable those precipitation becomes. And then especially after 2005, it's getting real wet here. And it, as I spoke about before, we know that Maine was in a drought this summer. Those, like, that, all that rain's happening in shorter periods, right? We're sort of getting, we're not getting this average rainfall. We're getting really wet, wet days and really dry, dry days. Right, last year there was that storm in June that knocked out like 10 miles of the carriage roads, I think. So super extreme rainfall. Okay, so the way that we can make these really fun maps and do these analysis are with this amazing data set called Global Historical Climatology Network Daily Data, GHCND data. And these dots are all the places around the world on land that we have meteorological data from. It's kind of amazing if you're a scientist. All of this is free, anyone can download it. So my initial thought was, let's just use this data. I know Bar Harbor has a site. Let's look at it. So let's zoom into Maine for a little bit. So here are all the stations around Maine. If it's a triangle, it's precipitation. If it's a circle, it's temperature. If it's a triangle on top of a circle, the station is both. And then it's color-coded by the number of years it's been in operation. So what you'll notice is that most of the weather stations and observational meteorological stations around Maine are quite new, right? They're all sort of hollow. They've all only been around for like 1 to 15 years, or they were around for 1 to 15 years and they died. There's about 20 stations around the state of Maine that have more than 50 years of data. Bar Harbor is one of them. So let's zoom in to MDI in Acadia National Park. There's a lot of new rainfall gauge stations here. That's pretty fun. But the three stations, oh, I do have a pointer. I know they gave me one. You ready? Oh, I did it. Okay, great. This yellow one, that's a Bar Harbor station. It's yellow. It has between 91 and 105 years of data. I think it actually has 100 years of data, which is amazing. And then there's two stations, Acadia and McFarland. And then there's a few precipitation stations around here. Climate scientists do not love it when you mix and match these data sets because meteorological stations are biased and they're really tough to create a long-term time series with. But I'm gonna show you what they look like anyway. Okay, so we have Bar Harbor station data from 1893 to 1982. It's kind of amazing. We have temperature and precipitation. I'm just showing you temperature and I'm just showing you average temperature in degrees Fahrenheit. You'll notice there are years without any data because all meteorological stations are just break sometimes and don't collect data. You'll notice the closer it gets to 1982, the less data points there are because the station started to just wear and tear. But people here acknowledge that that was happening. And they put a station up a little farther away. I mean, I'm in Southwest Harbor now, and when I sometimes make the drive from Southwest Harbor to my favorite walk at Little Long Pond, I'm like, oh my God, there's two different seasons happening here. So I knew this is gonna be tricky to deal with, but we can add the data from the Acadia station. That was running from 1982 to 2014, that purple one. And then the one, what's really nice about the McFarland station, what they put right next to it, so that's great. And there's years of overlap, which is also great. But you'll notice, even in some of these years of overlap, and even though some of the stations are literally right next to each other, they don't average out to the same temperature. So that is why climate scientists really do not want you to say, let's just take all three data sets, put them together, and put a trend line through it. It's not statistically robust. I'm just going to show you three trend lines through them anyway. They're all showing it's getting hotter anyway, right, in Acadia National Park. So it's tricky to deal with these station data sets. They're really complicated, statistical ways to do it. I'm not going to do those things because other data sets exist that help me get around that. They're gridded data sets that take station data, take satellite data, take other data, do really intense statistical modeling to come up with the best idea for what the temperature was on January 1st, 1970, right? So this is what I have used. So initially, if you know anything about climate data sets, I was gonna use PRISM data. If you're familiar with PRISM data, but that only gets you back to 1981. I wanted to go back farther in time than that. When I started this project, this data set did not exist, but then COVID happened and then I had a baby, so this project got super delayed. But in the meantime, these scientists came out with this amazing data set called ERA 5 land. So sometimes procrastination works out in your favor. It goes back until 1950 to 3 months before the present. It's climate reanalysis data. It's the best data set we have out there right now. There's 9 kilometer grid spacing. I mean, I'm showing you what each grid looks like over Acadia. I'm not saying it's magic, right? But I do have 4 data points over MDI that get me back daily data. I have 1 data point per day. Well, actually for every 3 hours since 1950, which is, and it's 1 consistent data set. So I can analyze that. And just to prove to you that it's not total trash, I did look to make sure that it somewhat agreed with the station data. So on these x-axes, you have temperature at Acadia. This is precipitation at Bar Harbor. And this is the gridded data set. And temperature, amazingly well correlated. Precipitation, kind of as good as it's going to get. Precipitation is always problematic. But showing you that you can trust this new data set that I waited a long time to come out and I knew it was happening. Okay, so now that we have data, which I didn't have for 2 years, or I played around with multiple ways and just got grumpy, we can answer the question, how has climate changed in Acadia National Park? So I defined a lot of climate variables that I was interested in. I looked at minimum temperature, which is the coldest it gets at night. I looked at maximum temperature, which is the hottest temperature it gets during the day. I looked at total precipitation. These are all very intuitive. Sorry, I haven't had to talk in a mask in a very long time. Okay, I looked at warm days, which are warmer than how many days are warmer than 95% of days? So if these are all of our data, and this is the temperature on the x-axis and the number of days at that temperature on the y-axis, for the number of warm days, I was like, okay, how many days are in this 95th plus percentile? How many days are on that warm side? And then for hot days, how many days are hotter than all but 99% of days? So I did that for days, for nights. I created variables for wet days, the number of days with at least 1 millimeter of rain. Rain days, a poor day. I called it a poor day. That's not a real name. But rainier than 95% days with at least some rain. Downpour days. So these are all the variables I created from this data set to look at to see if there are any trends over time. And just to show you guys what the actual numbers associated with these are with this data set. So warm days were the number of days warmer than 79 degrees. Hot days were the number of days warmer than 85 degrees, right? Hot nights were the number of nights that were warmer than 63 degrees. Downpour days, any day that had more than 2.5 inches of rain. So those are all the numbers taken from that ERA5 data set. Okay, and what we see is that since 1950, in Acadia National Park specifically, night temperatures have increased 2.17 degrees. Day temperatures have increased 2 degrees. It's 4.5 inches rainier than it was in 1950, which is a lot. If you look, warm nights, there's almost a month more of warmer nights than there were in 1950, which is a real problem in Maine, right? Because no one here has AC. I freak out if it's hotter than 68 degrees during the day. Warm days are getting hotter. Rain, there was no statistical trend in the number of rainy days or poor days, but there are 4.2 more days where it downpours than it did in 1950. And then I wanted to break it down by season because I care about the fall. And there's a little key. Winter is December, January, February. Spring is March, April, May. Summer is June, July, August, fall, September, October, November. Spring, nothing's really happening temperature-wise, which is interesting. Rainfall, yes. Minimum temperatures are getting hotter across the board, as are maximum temperatures. It's getting a lot rainier in the fall than any other season. And then just with these funky variables I created, because I thought they'd be really important. So when I disentangled climate and fall foliage, and they were not at all. Just so you know, summers are getting real hot and it's not just you, right? And those nights, it's really in those nights. And fall too. Warm nights in the fall are increasing, and that's going to become an important, that's going to become important later. Okay, we answered that first question already. That was like a year's worth of research. So how depressing is that? But how has Acadia National Park's climate changed? Hotter nights. It's warmer in all the seasons except spring, really. Spring's a little rainier, but there's not much happening temperature-wise there. And it's wetter in all seasons, especially the fall. Can this be, I guess we'll save questions at the end. Okay. So then I was like, great. We know how the climate's changing. Is fall foliage actually changing? When I started this project, I was like, I'm gonna get at when it started, when it ended, duration, color vibrancy. I'm a terrestrial remote sensor. I know how to analyze satellite data. I can do all these things. No, I cannot. So this question became, how has the timing of peak fall foliage changed in Acadia National Park? And I'll talk about why. And before I talk about why, let me talk about spring. You study the spring, you have it very easy. There are so many historical records of spring that exist. Aldo Leopold, Thoreau, they're all writing about phenology. My favorite data set of all time that I use in my classes is peak cherry blossom day that they have from Japan starting in 1812, which is amazing. And terrifyingly, it's getting a lot earlier if you look at that data set up there. But people talk about spring all the time. People, I think, are really excited that winter's over. So when they see that first flower, they write it down. You don't really do that with fall. And then trees and flowers tend to have blooming events where everything sort of happens within a day of each other. This doesn't really happen with fall phenology, right? Okay, so now this is where I complain about fall. Amanda Gallinat wrote this great paper that I love the title of, Autumn, the Neglected Season in Climate Change Research, because it really is understudied compared to all the other seasons, particularly spring. And she has this great table where she breaks it down to say, look at how many more studies there are for spring and not autumn. And it's because fall is pretty complicated. There are really complex drivers. We actually still really have, particularly with trees and flowers and plants, haven't really fully figured out the mechanics of why trees and flowers and plants do the things they do. Bud burst and leaf out in spring, like I was saying, it usually all happens within a day of each other. Fall, you have these protracted events, right? You see the leaves of a maple leaf turning in September, but then that whole tree is not going to turn until the middle of October. How do you write that down, right? I'll show you this in a second. There are very few standardized methods for evaluating changes in fall phenology. But it's so, so, so important to understand because it signals the end of the growing breeding season for so many animal species. Birds migrate in August, insects migrate. Understanding these interactions are super important, but it remains understudied. And I didn't really understand just how understudied it was before I started this, before I went on this journey that I'm taking you all on me on. Okay. This is just to show you that these are four different places that all think about fall foliage in very different ways. So the Maine Department of Agriculture, Seas Conservation and Forestry, this is their scale for fall foliage, very low, low, moderate, high peak in the percentages for what they consider. Then you go to weather.com, which a lot of people use. Their peak is somehow different than like the Department of Forestry's peak. And then you have a long-term ecological site, which is Harvard Forest. And you have the USDA Forest Service. And these are science like agencies. So at LTER sites, like Harvard Forest, they go out every 3 to 7 days and they just say percentage of leaf fall, percentage of leaf color. There's no range. But if you're working for the USDA Forest Service, you go out and you just say 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. You go out every 3 to 7 days, and you're like, are most of the leaves falling? It's a 0. Are many leaves having noticeable reddening? Then it's a 3. So it's really hard to even compare between two similar sites, right? Geographically, what's going on? I was explaining this to my husband. There's that Supreme Court case in the 1960s, and the guy was like, I know when I see it. I feel like that is fall. Like, you know what peak is when you see it, right? Is fall a vibe? I don't know. So not only are there very few long-term data sets, inconsistent tracking of these events. There's really no consensus in the peer-reviewed literature about what is happening with fall. So a study, 1953 to 2005, on Japan and South Korea, fall is getting later, and it's trending later faster than the way spring is trending. Great, fall is getting later, love it. Okay, just kidding. You look at New England, 2001 to 2012, leaf off is earlier by the coast, but later in the northern areas. Okay, that's cool too. Okay, if you look totally just east of the Mississippi River, if you look before the 1980s, it was getting later. If you look after the 1990s, it's getting earlier. Great. Northern Hemisphere, delays across the board. Different study, Northern Hemisphere, earlier across the board. Massachusetts, 2002 to 2013, peak shifting to earlier. Do I have one more on here? So you can see that there's really no consensus about what is happening with the timing of fall anywhere, right? And I think a lot of it is because it's so hard to disentangle. So I was like, don't worry, I'll do it for Acadia though. Let me add my name to this mix. Let me throw that up there. So my original research plan, because I'm trained as a terrestrial remote sensor, I know how to analyze satellite data on land, I know how to look at phenology, was to use tried and true remotely sensed methods to determine the timing of fall foliage back to the year 2000, because that's when we have consistent daily satellite data. And then I was like, oh, I'll just rely on community science to backfill my gaps and validate all my remotely sensed data. Check, check, so easy. Let's talk about why that was, yeah, I wrote spoiler alert, neither proved successful, and I'll talk about why. I can first talk about why remote sensors love monitoring vegetation. So you probably all know this, plants look green because they reflect green light and they absorb red and blue light. They also though, if you look at that white arrow showing you, they reflect a lot of light in the near infrared. So we can only see blue, green, red light. Near infrared is the closest wavelength to red, but our eyes can't pick it up. If we could, plants would look bright white to us. This is near infrared photography of a plant. They reflect so much near infrared light, and remote sensors use this fact all the time. Because if you look at this is a spectrum of a leaf where you have wavelength of light on the x-axis and reflectance, how much light is reflected on the y-axis. Our eyes can only see where it says visible right here. Here's blue light, here's red light, here's green light. So you can see that this plant is absorbing blue light, it's absorbing red light, and it's reflecting green light. That's that little bump, the little 10% reflectance of green light. That's why plants look green to us. It's reflecting, this is the near infrared, a heck of a lot of near infrared light, right? Scientists use this relationship that healthy photosynthesizing plants reflect a ton of near infrared light and absorb a lot of red light all the time. And they do it, if you ever talk to a remote sensor, we love our what we call indices. So this is the normalized difference vegetation index. And what it essentially just does is it looks at the difference in every leaf or plant or green thing that a satellite can see between near infrared light and red light. So here's like a healthy photosynthesizing tree. You can see it's reflecting a lot of near infrared light. It's absorbing 8% of the red light. So that means the NDVI will be pretty close to one. And this green line right here is our healthy vegetation. As plants stop creating chlorophyll, as they stop shutting down photosynthesis, as they stop absorbing red light, that the amount of near infrared light they reflect decreases a bunch. So this brown line is unhealthy vegetation, or we could pretend it's this just fall tree. And you can see that because it's no longer absorbing red light for photosynthesis, it's actually reflecting a bunch. The plants actually look like the leaves look orange and red to us, right? And it's actually reflecting a lot less near infrared light. So remote sensors really, really, really take advantage of the fact that the in a healthy plant, this is a big number, this is a small number, you get a big number. In a plant that's shutting down photosynthesis, these numbers are pretty similar, so it's smaller. And this is super powerful, even though it might not seem like it. Because if you have data, which we do, satellites pass over our head every day and take pictures, and they collect the amount of near infrared light being reflected back from Earth, and the amount of red light being reflected back from Earth, you can actually create what's called a time series of vegetation over vegetation, NDVI, but you can literally just think of this as how green is this plant? Like if you can cross this out and write greenness, and you can see this is day of year, so January to December, winter, there's nothing going on. And then as the plant starts photosynthesizing, that greenness, how green it looks to a satellite, gets higher and higher. And then during the fall, when senescence starts, it goes back down. And we can measure this and the date that these events happen, green up, maturity onset, peak, senescence onset, dormant phase, every day. You can even make really cool maps of it. So this is a map of the median green update for all vegetation across the United States between 2000 and 2013. And we essentially have these data all over the world. Super, super, super powerful. And I'm explaining this to you because I thought I could use similar methods to tell me about when that you get that green down curve. Because as you can see, the green goes with the green, yellow goes with the yellow, red goes with the red, brown goes with the brown. This is the amount, that's his wavelength again, and the amount of light reflected back. That relationship between the amount of near infrared light reflected and the amount of red light absorbed or reflected changes as the leaf changes color. So there's this thing in the remotely sensed literature called the normalized brownness index. Zhang and Goldberg created it. And basically what they did was they were focusing on New England, and they said, okay, I'm gonna isolate pixels that have more than 75% deciduous forest. If you're a remote sensor, you know this data set, MODIS 500 BDRF data set. I'm going to calculate that NDVI, what I just showed you. Then I'm going to smooth interpolate the time series, which is remotely sensed thing. And then I'm going to look at just this half of the time series, because that's the half we care about, because that's the fall half, and fit this curve to this line. And I'm going to figure out what A and B are. Great. And then I'm going to use what I figured out A and B are and put it in this new equation and calculate what they call the normalized brownness index. And I know how to do that. I was like, great, I can code this up. No problem. Let's do it. And what in their paper, they showed that NBI because you have this for every day of that whole half of the time series. This was their relationship to percent of colored leaves. And they're like, okay, if your NBI is between 0.6 and 0.85, that means you've hit peak fall foliage. I was like, great, I can do this. This is literally what I went to grad school for. And I did, and that's fine. However, if you know anything about the vegetation in Acadia National Park, you might notice a real big problem with the very first bullet, which is the fact that they ran it on pixels that were greater than 75% deciduous forest. So let's look at a map of vegetation in Acadia. Acadia is mostly conifers. So joke's on me there. And I knew that, right? Like, I've been here. But here's a great map from the Acadia National Park Vegetation Mapping Project. And so your dark green is evergreen forest land. Your, I guess we'll call it an okra, is mixed forest land or middle green. And I tried to highlight the orange being your deciduous forest land. Okay. Also, if you know your Acadia history, you know there's a big fire in 1947. I think over 17,000 acres burned, actually. And you can see the fire spreading. It was really small, that little dark green. Oh, I have this pointer. Right here, October 17th to 20th. And then it sort of blew out into the whole national park. This is important for fall foliage because Acadia used to be even more conifers. And then this fire happened. And then sun-loving trees like maples and birches and what else we have here, aspens, oaks, they could come in through because that whole land was cleared. So you won't be surprised if we toggle back and forth here where that deciduous vegetation is in Acadia National, well, most of it is, I should say. Okay, so when we're thinking about fall foliage data, we really only care about the data after 1950 anyway, right? Okay, let's go back to my remote sensing problem. Which way am I going here? Remote pixels of data, of satellite data, this MODIS data, are each represented by these little blocks here. Okay, so one block is one pixel of data. And then I'm just gonna get rid of the background to make it a little less busy. But over 2000 pixels cover MDI. Great. Okay. There are only 104 pixels of data with more than 50% deciduous, or I was being generous here, deciduous and mixed forest cover. If you go to, let's just look at what's more than 50% deciduous forest cover in one pixel, you're left with the 24 pixels in orange. And if you're like, okay, remember how they use pixels with more than 75% deciduous forest? You got 3 pixels left. That's really not great for your data and robustness of satellite stuff. So let's go back to the drawing board, right? So what I did was I was very generous with myself. And I looked at the 104 pixels with more than 50% deciduous or deciduous mixed forest cover. And I said, okay, let's just look at the timing of peak fall foliage in these pixels over the 21 years we have data. And it's kind of a mess. Day of year 280 is October 7th. Day of year 300 is October 27th. So you can see that's varying like crazy over the last 20 years. But you would be right to be like, do we even trust this? Fair question. We're going to come back to this. You could actually see from that slope that y equals negative 0.07. There's no trend, but it's getting a little bit earlier. And then if you're a climatologist, you really love having 30 years of data to decide on a trend, right? So we'll come back to this. But this was, I mean, I did it, but I didn't trust it that much. So I was like, let's go the community science lens. I knew that I wasn't going to have data before 2000 anyway, because that's when satellites really started getting daily data. So when I first started this project, I went and wrote for anyone and anyone that would have me to talk about sending me your old fall foliage photos. Because the Acadia National Park visitor it's actually very interesting compared to other national parks, in that most visitors to Acadia National Park are repeat visitors. You go to Yosemite, you go to the Grand Canyon, you ask, is this your first time at the park? A majority of people would say yes. That's not true of Acadia. I know a lot of people who are like, I've been coming up every Indigenous Peoples Day since whenever, right? So basically, I was like, I very foolish. And I also put signs around the park. That's me in 2019, asking people to leave peep for science and take pictures to help me validate the satellite data. And also being like, can I have your data? The scientific publication called My Research Basic, which I loved as a basic white lady. But anyone and anywhere that would have me, I was just like, please, please, please send me your photos. And I did get some, right? This is a photo of Northeast Harbor from 1987. This is a really nice one in 1981, Grand Cadillac. Photo in 2013, 2019. This guy, Bill Skokpol, who I accidentally drove past his house the other day, and I knew it because I was like, hey, I know that name that's on that house. He has a house on Little Echo Lake, and he is one of these people that's just been taking pictures the same place every year. I mean, it's amazing, right? He comes up the same weekend every year and takes a picture of his view. That was a great resource. But shockingly, I did thousands of photos were not pouring into my inbox. People were not gifting me their old albums. So how did we even get, I didn't give up because I am persistent and resilient, and that's probably why I'm still in this field. So how did we answer this question? Well, what we did is we dug into the archives. I had a student at the University of Richmond, Olivia Hubert, she's the best. And she spent the whole 6 months to a year after she graduated helping me out with this work, digging into the archives, specifically looking at these newspapers and these summary monthly narrative reports. So like this one's from 1924, before Acadia had even been called Acadia, they called it Lafayette National Park. And this like beautiful, like October has been a record-breaking month in Lafayette National Park. Not only has it been the busiest October, it's gone far ahead of other months of the season. Equally important too is the fact that the oldest resident of Mount Desert Island can remember no such Indian summer weather as October's walk to the park this year. Splendid banners of fall, scarlet, gold, pale yellow, and deep maroon coloring the woods and reflecting the beautiful inland waters and transforming the mountains into realms of magic. It's a government report. It's like pretty good, right? But we have other slightly more useful and boring ones. The peak of autumn color occurred about October 7th. Great, data point, check. And so Olivia dug and dug and dug and dug into the archives. And basically we created this data set that goes start to 1950 to today. And you see day of year, timing of peak fall foliage, because that's all it's really written about, from 1950 to today. And what we see is that the timing of peak fall foliage is about 9 days later today than it was in 1950 in the park. And just to go back to that remotely sensed data set, if we look at the historical data from our archives from the last 20 years, it's also kind of a hot mess. So the last 20 years have just been really unpredictable in terms of fall foliage. So I actually don't think that remotely sensed effort was as awful as it could have been. Okay, but we have this long-term data set, and we're sticking with it, and I'm moving through this talk. Okay, so then we answer this question, delayed over a week since the 1950s, become more unpredictable. How have climate changes affected fall foliage? So now we want to put it together, right? How are these two things related? How are these changes in climate affecting that timing? Okay. We'll quickly go over why leaves change color, but I don't think we actually need to do that for this talk. Leaves have chlorophyll, makes them green. In this, it makes sense for them to do that, to photosynthesize and create carbon in the summers when you have all the light. But then it starts to get cold and you start to have less daylight. So they start to shut down those chlorophyll machines. And so chemicals like carotenoids and xanthophylls, they're in the leaves the whole time, but they're masked by chlorophyll. But in the fall, once that chlorophyll production shuts down, you see the yellows that were there, the whole yellows and oranges that were there the whole time. Reds are trickier. Only certain trees make anthocyanins that are reds, and I can go into this later, but I want to leave time for questions. And it has to do with sugar. And the best thing you can have to create bright reds are cool sunny day or sunny days and cool nights. Best reds when that happens. Okay, and the conventional wisdom is that day length and temperature, trees can sense when the nights are changing, when it's getting, the light, days are getting shorter and it's getting colder. Let's go to the trouble with fall again, but I'm gonna skip through this. Trust me when I tell you, no one knows actually what actually forces a tree to start senescing, to start shutting down chlorophyll production. So let's go back to our real question. How have changes in climate affected the timing of fall foliage? If you're into the statistics, I can talk about it, but I'll go through it pretty quickly. I created all these variables that I thought might have to, that might affect the timing of peak fall foliage. And I tested to see what was correlated. I tested for autocorrelation. I ran like 40 statistical models using variable selection techniques. I determined the best model, which I'll leave here on the table. It's that one on the right has the lowest error. And I'll talk about what this all means in a second. But basically, if we just look at average September temperature in that top line, what this is saying is that if you hold every other variable constant, for every 1 degree Celsius in temperature September increases, fall foliage is going to be delayed about 3 days, 2.8 days. You can do this for all the other variables. I'll talk about it more in a second. This is the summary of that table that I think is far more readable. September temperatures are the strongest determinant of the timing of fall foliage here in Acadia. Warm September delays fall foliage. If you get a lot of rain in the first week of October, it advances the timing of peak fall foliage. There's a sweet spot of rain in September. Too much rain is bad. Too little rain is bad. Medium rain is great. And then spring precipitation, for some reason, was always significant. Always. But what that last model actually is just a math equation. So I wanted to test my own model. So that's the fancy math equation. For this year, I grabbed temperature from the McFarland data, and I grabbed precipitation data from two new stations in Southwest Harbor. I plugged it all in. And this model said peak fall foliage on Mount Desert Island this year should occur last Friday. It was very stormy last Friday, but I don't think it was that bad. Here's some beautiful pictures I took around. I think this week, this is from last week. Maine releases it on Wednesdays. I'm pretty sure this week will be at peak. It was pretty nice out at the end of last week. That wasn't Friday. Great, great marathon. That's from the top of Cadillac. That model's okay. I also did a thing, but I want to get to the better part of the talk, where we looked at, I just threw some new climate change scenarios in. It gets later in every scenario. Fall foliage does by 2060. Okay. So we've answered so many questions already. Now, warmer falls relate to delays, precipitation is complex. Climate models predict here peak fall foliage getting later. So what do Acadia National Park visitors consider when they plan their trip? This is really important, right? Because leaf peeping here is a huge industry. Counts for 20% of the annual tourism in Maine. If people have more recent data, please send it to me. I've been digging. And Acadia National Park is also really important for Maine's economy. And visitation in the park has been increasing, particularly in the months of September and October. That shoulder, this graph is showing you the average increase in visitors every year since 2000. It's huge in September, October, right? So what I've been doing in 2019 and this year is I go out, or I have texts from Scudic go out late September, end of October, and they give visitors a short survey in the park. That student Olivia also designed this postcard. She's so talented. And we give them a short survey, and we sort of beg them to fill out a longer survey. And I'm gonna present to you really early results right now, because I spent the last 4 months focusing on all that other stuff. So in 2019, we had 164 short surveys filled out, 81 longer ones, 49% response rate, 54% of people said it was their first visit to Acadia, And every dot on that map shows where a survey was from. The demographics of the data were perhaps not surprising if you've been to Acadia in the fall. 96% of respondents were white, and the average age was 56, and the median age was 62. And then I thought this was interesting. So this is a little complicated, but I broke down the people by when they planned their visit, day of visit, a week ago, a month ago, 1 to 6 months ago, more than 6 months, more than a year, and whether or not they considered the timing of fall foliage. And you'll notice that most people plan their visits 1 to 6 months ago, and yes, very much considered the timing of fall foliage when they plan their visits. Olivia made this, we also asked them what's the main reason they came to the park, and Olivia made this word tree cloud, I guess. You'll see foliage and hiking are at the top of the list. And then we ask about climate change. How important is the issue of climate change to you? Most people said extremely important. But then you ask, how concerned are you about the effects of climate change on Acadia National Park? That skew disappears, which is interesting. And right, I haven't really dug into this data. I just wanted to leave you all, I didn't realize until I was going through this data that I left a blank spot for people who said, anything else you guys want to add? And they were fun to read. Most beautiful preserved location on the Eastern Seaboard. Applaud the teams that created and maintained the stonework. Nice visit. Can't imagine what it would be like coming during the busy season. Too many cars on Cadillac. No car should be up there. People should be bussed up. Can you put a topo map at the top of Cadillac? Sure thing. That's not my research. Wish it was closer to New Jersey. Didn't love the cruise ships. Obviously, that's contentious here. Yes, this survey was too long and we couldn't find the trailhead for Cadillac. Like, okay, I'll take that feedback. Fun, you guys should have more fun little lodge spaces and chili and hot cocoa, just saying. So full support on that one. Okay, I just zoomed through that. So what did we learn in the last 50 minutes? Acadia National Park is hotter, particularly at night, warmer in all seasons except spring, wetter in all seasons, especially fall. Fall foliage is delayed over a week since the 1950s, and the timing is getting more and more unpredictable. Warmer falls are related to delays. Precipitation is complex. If you throw that model in with some climate projection data, it's projected to be later and later in the fall, the time of peak foliage. And the trips here are being planned far in advance. I will say anecdotally, from the surveys I gave out this year, most people say they planned their trips over a year ago. Actually, and at least half the people here are considering the timing of peak fall foliage when they plan their trips. Ooh, that was a marathon. Thanks to the Skudik Institute, Nick, Catherine Schmidt, Emma, A. Miller Rushing. I had two students work on this with me, Olivia and Mark. My colleague Keith is my resource when it comes to stats. And then my husband Chris, we've been up here for 4 months without childcare, and he's been the primary caretaker. So that's been a time. If you have any questions, I think we have like 5 minutes. Great. Whew. Okay, that's my talk. Yeah. Sure. Oh, you, yeah, yeah, 100%. Yeah, so I'm supposed to repeat the question, right? Great, got it, getting head nods in the back. So droughts and drought stress. So right, stress trees do senesce earlier. Even the waterlogged stress trees do, but if they get super stressed, there's a cool name for it and I'm blanking on it now. But when they literally, like the leaves look fried to you, right? And everything falls off. So in every run of these models, I did have a drought variable, like how many days with no rain. And I think it became significant in a few of them and it always made it earlier. But it is, I mean, I'm modeling it very simplistically, just with a multivariate linear regression, right? And I only explain about half the variance in the data set with that, even the best model. But you do see it when it comes up as significant, it is getting earlier. Thank you. It's interesting, right? Jessup Path, those maples always go first too, because they're waterlogged and stressed in a different way because they're all marshy. Yeah. Stress trees. So that's why half of that literature that I zoomed through, some people think that's why fall foliage is actually occurring earlier, because trees are going to get more stressed. So if that controls more than the temperature, and then a lot of people think it's species specific, which I did not look at even a little bit, right? Good question though. Yeah. Oh, I got to publish that first part. And then I'm really excited to dig into the survey data from this year too, because it's really interesting to have this like pre-pandemic outlook and then this post-pandemic outlook. And I feel like we've all changed a lot in the last 3 years. So that'll be interesting. And then meeting with Abe and Nick to give, because it's really important for park managers too, right? To know what's happening with visitorship. I was in the park doing surveys the Tuesday after Indigenous Peoples Day, and people were irate that the Island Explorer had shut down. And I mean, that wasn't my job, but I heard about it, right? So I think there's interesting things in terms of park management too. If there's more and more people coming later and later. If someone wants to fund me to do this somewhere else, happy to take that money. Yeah. Ooh, I definitely did not. But what's interesting, right, is I have to repeat the next question. How, thanks. Okay, responsive age of tree to timing of fall foliage, particularly as we have this sort of amazing weird control with this fire. What's interesting about MDI, I guess, what's kind of nice experimentally is that most of the trees are all the same age. So I don't know if anyone has looked at how trees respond differently. I'll come back to that. Fall is so understudied that, but that's a really interesting question, right? Like, do trees respond differently to different climate signals as they age? That's a great question that I do not know the answer to. There's a lot of I don't knows, and I'm very comfortable saying that. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, why the timing of fall foliage is becoming less predictable. I think it's a lot of things. I think it's like what you were saying, more droughts, right? We don't know what that does. More extreme precipitation events. There is, the only extra slides I have are, there's one long-term data set of fall foliage. It is the best. It is from Polly's Pancake Parlor in Sugar Hill, New Hampshire. They've been keeping a record of onset, almost gone, and peak fall foliage since 1975. And I obviously took this PDF and plotted the data. And what's really interesting is that they see the leaves are starting to turn color earlier, 5 days earlier every decade. That's such a strong line. But similar trend line to peak, their peak is getting later too. But I distinctly remember this data point, storms. We're seeing more intense precipitation events. You could get, you could be on your way to a beautiful showing of fall foliage, and you get a storm come through, and there go all the leaves, right? And your just peak is what it was. So I think as we've seen weather, which is baby climate, right, become more erratic because of climate change, I think that's feeding into this variability, particularly over the last 20 years. That's a good question. Elizabeth. They do. Yeah, so Elizabeth asked if the Park Service keeps records of visitation, 100% do monthly records of visitation every year, and if that relates. And the only thing I can say, because they don't, I mean, it's really interesting, right? Because it's like, are those visitors happening the first 2 weeks of October? They don't break it down that finely. But if you look at the, there it is. So last fall was the most, I think, visitors September and October had had. And this is where I put, I took visitorship from 2000 on for each of these months. And I just looked at the trend lines and I said, which ones were increasing, which ones were decreasing, and by how much? It's starting to rain. And you'll see that January and February visitorship is decreasing, but this is all from park visitor data. But I don't know if that October is really October. And then Nick's actually done really cool research that showed that just the lengthening of the shoulder seasons, it's getting warmer in the spring and in the fall. People want to go to national parks farther north more because it's not as cold. Much higher percentage of people visiting, much higher median age. Right. So he said for people on Zoom, because Sarah's nodding him. Yeah, great. Is that the biggest increase was in people, younger people with families getting outside more, particularly post-pandemic? Right. Okay. Did I get that right? Great. I mean, it was funny reading the surveys, be like, too many tourists here. I was like, you're a tourist here. I'm a tourist here. We're all tourists here. I mean, you're not, but this is my national park. Fun fact, don't do surveys at Jordan Pond House. Everyone there is really grumpy all the time. That's what I learned too. Yeah, thank you all so much for hanging out for the last hour.